things shoved back in the corners of the bookshelves that were there when I arrived 13 and a half years ago. And over the last few days and weeks, I have received such an outpouring of gratitude from people in person via cards and emails and text messages. And I don't think anybody was thanking me for all those diocesan conventions that I went to and collected the thick spiral-bound journals that went into the recycling yesterday. They weren't thanking me for all those meetings where I stood at the easel pad and took notes. They weren't thanking me for all the service bulletins. In fact, in most cases, it's pretty clear that they weren't really sure what they were thanking me for. Which is as it should be. Because the gratitude was mutual. It wasn't that they were thanking me for having delivered religious services on time and under budget. Although we can certainly treat religion that way, like anything else. We can treat it like a commodity that we produce and consume. Now, I think that what we're grateful for is so much deeper and bigger, more mysterious than that. This is what Jesus goes up to the temple in the second chapter of John to remind the people there about. But this place is not a market. We don't produce things here for people to consume. We don't add more stuff to the world to help people assimilate it into their story about themselves so they can feel better about it. And when Jesus' disciples see him doing what he does there, overturning the tables of the money changers, and driving the sacrificial animals out, a whole herd of cattle and sheep that were going to be slaughtered and consumed, driving them out into the streets of Jerusalem. When they see him doing this, they remember something written in the Psalms, Psalm 69. Zeal for your house will consume me. Zeal for your house will consume me. It's like they have a premonition in that moment of what is to come. That Jesus will pour out his life. Not so that we can take it for ourselves and grasp it and use it to embellish our story about ourselves, but so that we can be consumed by his body we can be subsumed into his body. That's what it means to be baptized. It means to be baptized into the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. To become part of his crucified and risen and glorified body. So that we live no longer for ourselves, but for him. The disciples really didn't understand this until he had risen from the dead. And then they remembered. They remembered that they had remembered. In that moment, when they saw Jesus in the temple performing his act of defiance, his prophetic judgment on all kind of false religion, they remembered that they had remembered the psalm in that moment. Zeal for your house will consume me. And then they remembered what Jesus had said when the people there at the temple had asked him for a sign. He said, tear down this temple, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. And they understood that he was speaking of the temple of his body. That the Father's house that he had said, do not turn my Father's house into a market about. That Father's house was for them. You know, in the 14th chapter of John, when Jesus is gathered with his disciples for a final meal on the night before he suffers, he talks about his Father's house. We often hear this passage at funeral services, where Thomas says, Lord, we don't know where you are going. How can we know the way? Before that happens, Jesus says, do not be afraid. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. And if I go away now, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again to you and bring you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. You see, the Father's house is not a building where people perform religious rituals. The Father's house is where God dwells. And later on in the 14th chapter of John, Jesus says, those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come and make our home with them. You are the Father's house. So don't be a market. Don't produce religious goods for others to consume. But remember to remember the body of Jesus raised from the dead. when we eat that body, it consumes us. It makes us into a house where God dwells. So, what are we grateful for about this 13 and a half years that we have spent together? Well, maybe just that Jesus keeps building that house. There was perhaps some doubt when I arrived here in 2010 whether he could do it again here. He did. He does. He will. He will raise up his body. He will make a place in it for each one of us. So thank you. Thank you all for being a part, as I have been a part of that body. Don't forget to remember the zeal of Jesus for this house. The zeal that was in Bill Armstrong and Rodney Chilton, and Joanne Woodland, and Bill Reed, and Kim Jacobson, Dolores Helmuth, Larry Temple, Victoria Temple. The zeal of Jesus for the Father's house that never dies. My going away doesn't change that at all.
Please stand as you're able, and together let us offer the Nicene Creed on page 5 in your service bulletin. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all the worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, for us and for our salvation, came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of Virgin Mary, and was made man. He was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and on the third day he rose again, according to the Scripture, ascended into heaven, and is seated on the right hand of the Father. He shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead. His kingdom shall have no end. Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Our compassionate and loving God has called us to repentance. May our prayers and our Lenten observances assist us in coming before God with pure hearts and minds, open to the ways of peace, healing, and reconciliation as we pray for our own needs and for the needs of the Church and for the world. We will pause briefly after each petition for you to add your own prayers of your own hearts.
God of love, we pray for your Church, for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Megan, our bishop, for all lay and ordained ministers, and for all who seek you in the community of the faithful, for the wardens and vestry of St. John's Petaluma, as we work together preparing for Father Daniel's departure and the interim period to follow. Equip us with compassion, courage, and love to carry out your work of reconciliation in our lives and in the world. God of love,
hear our prayers to the Church.
God of freedom, we pray for our nation and all the nations of the world, for peace and unity across barriers of language, color, and creed, for elected and appointed leaders, that they would serve the common good. Inspire all people with courage to speak out against hatred, to actively resist evil, unite the human family in bonds of love. God of freedom. God of justice, we pray for the earth, your creation entrusted to our care, for the animals and birds, the mountains and oceans, and all parts of your creation that have no voice of their own. Stir up in us a thirst for justice that protects the earth and all its resources, that we may leave to our children's children the legacy of beauty and abundance that you have given us. God of justice,
hear our prayers to you.
God of peace, we pray for this community, for our local leaders, for parents and children, for students, for our neighborhoods and workplaces, for first responders, mental health workers, social workers, educators, those who work and volunteer in hospitals, shelters, food distribution centers, group homes, care facilities, and clinics. Kindle in every heart a desire for fair treatment, equality, respect, and opportunity for all. Give us the courage to strive for justice and peace among all people, beginning here at home. God of peace,
hear our prayers to this community.
God of healing, we pray for the sick and all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, for those who are lonely and despairing, for those who are alienated and enraged, for those who are anxious about their physical and mental health, and those without access to affordable health care. We pray for healing of our own brokenness, and we offer special intentions for those on St. John's prayer list. Presiding Bishop Michael Curry, Mike, Lessa, Lynn and Gary, Gerald, Gloria, Tony, Bob, Dave and Nancy, Jackie, Sylvia, Father Daniel, Meg and Risa, Deacon Lori, Jasmine, Leanne, Deborah, Cindy, Addie, John, Ellen, Lee, and Dylan. Are there others you would like to name? God of healing, God of mercy, we pray for your people in any kind, any need or trouble, for those whose lives are closely linked with ours, and those connected to us as part of the human family, for refugees and migrants, hostages, soldiers and prisoners, for those who are unemployed or underemployed, for all who face violence and oppression in their homes or workplaces, for all people held down or hurt by prejudice or injustice, awaken in us compassion and humility of spirit as we seek and serve Christ in all persons. God of mercy,
hear our prayers for us.
God of grace, we pray for those who have died, especially for those on St. John's prayer list, Alexi, Janet, Jimmy, Deacon Virginia McNeely, Kay, and Linda. Are there others you would like to pray for?
Dylan.
Jimmy. We pray for the faithful in every generation who have worked for justice, for prophets who called us to racial reconciliation, for martyrs who died because of hatred, for Saints Perpetua and Felicity and their companions who encouraged one another in a time of trial, for Mary, Christ's mother, for Saint Gregory of Nyssa. Grant that we who cherish their blessed memory may share in their pure and steadfast faith. Make us faithful to your call to proclaim your good news by word and example, and bring us at last into the glorious company of the saints in light. God of grace,
hear our praise for all the faithful.
Almighty God,
blessed Son, before his passion,
prayed for his disciples that they might be one, even as thou and he are one. Grant that thy church, being bound together in love and obedience to thee, may be united in one body by the one Spirit, that the world may believe in him whom thou didst send, the same thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the same Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you.